Yo, this is your boy Rex, and you are now tuned in to Backspin TV. We live in Hamburg, Germany. This is the top of the tour, and we about to get busy. Stellwerk, you know what it is. Call grenades.com, rexhiphop.com, showoffhiphop.com. We a movement, the evolution of revolution, baby.
I'm gonna write this here rhyme like gurus in the passenger. Standing on the East Coast, staring out to Africa. Accolades, escalates, fade. My vernacular remain intact for the generation that's coming after the average rapper you praise. Days number like a calendar, challenger's caliber. Mediocre into the catheter, IVs wrap them up. Mad as fuck, need a ladder up. Escalator, elevator, skyscraper, hella haters.
So Rex, welcome to Hamburg City. Very glad to have you on the show. Thank you for having you on our show. Backspin TV, you are in Europe, Hamburg tonight. First of all, I wanted to come back to your roots, because I heard that you've been starting as a b-boy in the Funk Town Connection.
Yeah.
How come that you switched from b-boying to MCing?
Okay, well, I started off as a b-boy real young, probably like 10, 11. My cousins was doing it. You know, hip-hop was brand new, it was fresh and vibrant. And I just wanted to be doing what my older cousins was doing. You know, they was teenagers. You know, I was a little cousin that was the bugaboo that wanted to, like, just be down with my cousins and do whatever they were doing. So, you know, it was just only natural that I did the b-boy thing. We did our thing for a while. Shout out to Funktown Connection, all my older cousins. Y'all hold y'all head. Lawrence, Massachusetts. We was in a, like, small mill city, just following what was going on in New York. So that's what it was.
And you still can do some moves, or?
Nah, you ain't gonna get me to do no moves. Like, I'll leave that to the professionals. I respect the art, man. Like, you know what I'm saying? The graffiti artists, the producers, the DJs, those who, you know, tailor their shit to the fashion, whatever it may be, you know what I'm saying? Whatever you do to keep this culture vibrant, I respect your art. My art is to hold that mic, you know what I'm saying? So that's what I keep on giving them.
And you're killing it.
Thank you.
And your name stands for Rhythmatic Eternal King Supreme, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So, in your words, what makes a man King Supreme?
Well, I mean, I just felt like from day one, like, Rex first and foremost being King, and, you know, following the likes of KRS-One with the acronym as well. I've always kept that name Rex, and to be King Supreme, I just felt like I'm divine, and I'm royal in my own state and in my own nature and my own talents. I carry that, you know, infinitely. It's a gift given by God. It's a talent given by God, and I'm able to carry forth that talent for the rest of my life based upon what was given to me, as long as I'm dedicated to the art form. You know, so, you know what I mean, I prevail because I stand royal. I feel like, you know, as a MC, you have to be willing to consider yourself, you know, throne worthy and crown worthy. And I feel like I've given enough of a catalog to, like, you know, let that name hold weight. So, Rhythmatic Eternal King Supreme forever, you know what I mean? Yeah.
The point was to me, what makes, in your own words, what makes a lyricist, real lyricist?
I mean, personally, I just feel like the ability to master the art form, like to creatively pen words that, like, you know, resonate with an audience. It's like, it's not just, you know, like I said, putting cookie cutter lyrics together and you know what I'm saying, you can make the word cookie rhyme with rookie, so that makes you a rapper. That don't make you no rapper, because you can say cookie and rookie.
Right.
So that's what it is.
And what is more important to you, the lyrical content or delivery flow and all that? Or
for me, I feel they all have you know, extreme importance. But for me, I also, at the same time, I think content stands the test of time. You know, I do this mainly now because I got two boys that later on I want to be able to have them look at my messages and have them resonate with them 10 years, 20 years from now. You know, if I'm dead and gone, I want them to be able to say, well, dad stood for something. He has something to say. Nah, he wasn't just making records, you know, to try to, like, make people dance, or he wasn't just making records to, like, you know, have people vibe out when they're riding in the whip. Like, I want to make people think, you know, so, like, that's why I have records like Parenthood. That's why I got records that, like, you know, talk to the kids, that talk to talk to the stories I've been through, and like people can relate to. So for me, it's always going to be about that lyrical content.
I feel you. So coming to the writing process of you, how do you write? Do you collect, like, your ideas, or do you write straight off the head, one song down?
I do it all, man. Like I'm in the lab, I'm outside of the lab. Whenever idea crosses my mind, I write, you know? I remember, like, you know, reading something from Tupac when Tupac said whatever emotion he was going through, he just put it down to paper. So, like, that's what I do. Like, anytime, you know, I'm angry, anytime I'm elated, anytime, like, you know, I got that feeling like, you know, we might just win a lot. Whatever the feeling may be that comes across me, I'm gonna write about it. You know what I'm saying? I have a good date with my girl. You know what I'm saying? Whatever the case may be, I wanna talk about it, because in all those emotions we come across, we evoke a relationship with the listener. Like, as long as we can, like, capture them with what we put on the pen and pad, you know. So, like, with me, I like to, like, do it immediately when that emotion's, like, vibrant in me. That passion is just, it's just natural for me to go to the pad.
And in the lab, when you're in the lab, what is your must have when you're recording or writing?
A notebook. Like, you know, I've from time to time have been caught, like, you know, rapping with a laptop or with something like that. But, like, at the end of the day, I'm still a writer in the original form of that. Like, as long as I got my notebook, I got my paper, I'm really good. You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't have to have alcohol in the studio. I don't have to have an entourage, a bunch of females. I don't got to have to all that. Like, I just want to be one with the mic, man. As long as I got that mic, I'm good to go.
So, coming from Lawrence, it's a city close to Boston, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, talking about your musical influences as the young Rex, I guess it was maybe Guru, Gangsta Affiliates, like Crumb Snatcher, or can you just tell me what was your musical influences as a young man?
Wait, are you asking me, like, who influenced me in Boston or
no, I mean,
in general?
Yeah, in general.
I mean, I got respect, and I've always saluted to the ones who have been able to pave the path before me from Lawrence and from Boston, such as Crumb Snatcher, such as Scientific, such as Edo G, such as Guru, Big Shug, all the cats who came before. But, like, for me, it's like, it wasn't just hip hop. It was a plethora of music. Like, I'm a fan of Marvin Gaye and Michael Jackson, and Stevie Wonder's, like, my favorite artist of all time. And, like, you know, all the way to Pink Floyd. You know, so, like, I listen to music. You know what I mean? Anything that can, like, resonate with a message, I'm down for it. But, like, the New York sound always transcended with me. You know what I'm saying? I was a big fan of Nasir Jones, big fan of Big Daddy Kane, KRS-One, and then you got Scarface, Ice Cube. I just love the genre. You know.
And looking at your discography, and the first time you started putting out music, like, in a 3-5 year cycle, and that changed in 2011 with Straight No Chaser. Since then you dropped, like, three LPs. So what changed that you dropped that music in such a short order?
I mean, I just want to suffocate the people. You know what I'm saying? Like, I feel like, you know, like, it's definitely quality over quantity. But at the same time, I feel like I can give you quality and quantity at the same time. If somebody who puts out terrible music can drop 10 mixtapes in a year, or, like, in a 2-year span, and, like, you just see their name everywhere on the internet, everywhere in the magazines, everywhere on the TV, like, I feel like I need to suffocate the game, because next week they don't give a damn what's going on with Rex. I'm so underneath the radar that, like, I feel like I gotta give people more of what I do and show them why I really feel I'm one of the best. You know what I mean? Like, if I don't feed the people, like, that nourishment, then, like, they're just gonna forget. They don't care. You know, there's just too much music out there.
So you're staying on your grind, that's the reason.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And it's said that you want to focus in the future, or already now, to one producer albums. Like, you worked with Static on Straight No Chaser, now with Mnemonics on Revolutionary. How come that you want to work with one producer for one album?
I mean, I just wanted to, like, do something different from what, like, my whole old repertoire was, you know. And I also got this project coming with a producer by the name of Hazardous Sounds called Eyes Watching God, and it's all produced by Hazardous. It's a crazy project. We got Noriega on there, Saigon's on it. It's just a dope project. And I mean, the main objective was to be able to sit in a laboratory and do what's not done anymore. People are mailing in music. Like, when I went to New York to meet with Static, because Static stays in New York now, when he's not flying all over the world. But, like, you know, Static's in New York, so like I'd make my trip up to New York and we sit there for a couple of weeks and we just bang out record after record. And that's that's you can't take that recipe and like you can't duplicate it. You know what I'm saying? It's just a different feeling you get when there's a producer sitting there and there's a rapper sitting there and you guys are tuned in and you're tapped into the same kind of cohesive project. And I think that's what me and Static have. I think that's what happened when me and Pneumonix had an idea. I sat in Pneumonix crib down in Florida and we just discussed the state of the day. You know, with the election year coming and like all the things that were going on in our neighborhoods. It's crazy because we live in Florida and the Trayvon Martin thing was happening where like, you know, little kids getting murdered, you know what I'm saying, and like we're dealing with all these like, you know, heavy issues. So like me and him saw eye to eye on a lot of things on like how the banking system is really, you know what I'm saying, at war with us, you know, and how we don't really recognize it for what it is. You know, we got the wool over our eyes, we blindfolded. So like it was easy to do that project. And with Hazardous, we come from some of the same environment. So like it was just like a carry on from what Revolutionary was. And we just needed to do that, like, you know, who's coming to save us type of record.
My now seen the coming of seduction, disgusting. Who to trust in the clutch ain't nobody worthy in the world we know. Burning them ashes past fingertips, final drips of glass I sip. The inner vision and glass is split. Have it, have not, the have not rock. The have benefit till we drop. Picking crops and cotton and then forgotten on blocks. What sounds of gunshots, alarm clock? How does it stop? Limited option, liberty or death. Branded the flesh like he was cattle, equivalent just figment of imagination babble. This generation lacks true knowledge of how the past has trapped you in psychological labs.
So you've been in Florida working with Pneumonix. How did you connect?
Pneumonix I met through, it's weird because originally I was living in Boston still and I had come to visit a friend who was staying in Tampa, Florida. And back then it was like, you know, you go to the streets and you sell your CDs, you know, out the trunk, or you go to the mall, you go to the like chop shop, whatever it may be. And I just happened to be at the mall one day selling one of my mixtapes, and he happened to be out there, and I didn't know him, he didn't know me. And it was prior to us ever working. And I went up to him and I was like, you're gonna buy my CD? And he's like, I'm not buying your CD. Like, he's like, I don't buy nobody's CD. Like, you know what I'm saying? He wasn't having it. And I was like, nah, you're gonna buy this CD. So we went to his web, I had him play it, and he was like, all right, I'm gonna buy the CD. He felt it. So a few years later, like my homies that live in Fort Lauderdale where Pneumonix moved to, and I had since then moved to as well, had been, they went to Pneumonix. They were like, yo, you gotta holler at my homie Rex. And he's like, Rex, I got his music, like, you know what I'm saying? And then like we linked up and he told me that story because I didn't even remember it.
Right.
And he's like, look, this is how we really met.
You know what I mean? Somebody to
yeah,
you, right?
It was what it was. Like, yeah. he didn't tell me he produced or anything. He didn't say, he was just, it was happenstance that we bumped into each other then. But then like, you know, a few years later, we end up in the booth together. So it's magical because I love what Pneumonix does, man. You know what I mean?
And talking about Revolutionary, you also already mentioned it. Like you worked from 2011 to early 2012, right?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And a lot of things happened, like the tragic shooting of Trayvon Martin, what you mentioned, or the election. Also the 9/11 anniversary, 10th anniversary. And you said that you want to spread the message to the youth, that all these things made you want to spread a message. So what is this message about that you want to give to the youth?
I mean, I just want them to take the wool off their eyes and recognize that, you know, first of all, when you have school systems that use dated books and try to, like, you know, teach you a history that's like falsified, then you're gonna continuously repeat a cycle of, like, you know, mental enslavement. When you have kids out there who have a wool over their eyes, so like they're out there doing whatever they need to do to like get that chain, to get that whip, to get that new chick because Rick Ross said it or Waka said it or somebody else said it, and they think that's what's popping, then they really are doing the backwards movements. And you know what I'm saying? My sons, I got a 9-year-old and I got a 2-year-old. Right. And no way in hell are my children going to be raised listening to that music?
You know what I mean? You're taking care of what they listen to, right?
I mean, I don't tell them what to listen to. My children can make their own decisions. They're free to think how they want to think. But I'm not going to allow them to listen to something that's detrimental to them. You know, like if my son wants to listen to, you know, Norah Jones, I don't care who it is. That's his choice. You know, as long as I listen to the lyrics and I'm like, okay, there's nothing offensive here or disrespectful here. There are lyrics of mine, like there's records like This or That, that I don't want my son listening to right now. 10 years from now, he can listen to it and understand what I was saying in those records and know why I was saying what I was saying. But no way in hell is my son's, either one of my sons gonna listen to a record like that right now. They're not gonna listen to terminology. You know what I'm saying? They can't understand or carry that kind of weight of a message. You know, right now it's about me having a dialogue with my children and telling them the realities of things. Important. Because if I have a dialogue with my son and I explain to him about a Trayvon, and I do this, you know, I explain to him why it occurs, then he can kind of capture in his own mind, maybe at 13 or 14, why Ice Cube made a certain record. And then it's okay for me to play him Ice Cube. And he can see why he's so aggravated and why he's so aggressive in a record. You know, and you know why he made something like America's Most Wanted, you know? But I don't want to just spoon feed my children and saying, oh, you're going to be a hip hop head, you're going to be a b-boy. I don't care what they listen to as long as they're respectful of themselves.
That's so important, man. I feel you. And talking about terminology, you mentioned his name and Static. I mean, you three come from Lawrence, but what is the special connecting link between you guys?
I mean, we just vibe, you know what I'm saying? Those are my brothers. At the end of the day, I don't have to talk to them every single day to know that they're my brothers. If I need anything, if they need anything, we're always going to be there for each other. Because it's bigger than just the music. I know that sounds cliche, but that's what it really is. You know, I was just with them 2 days ago before I came here. You know, we shot a video for our homie Superstar Snuck. Big up to him. You know, we did the record On the Wall. You know what I'm saying? Against the Wall, I should say. It's me, Term, and Snuck on that record. I don't even want to throw it out there because I was getting ready to say another record that was produced by another homie. But yeah, like, you know what I mean? Those are my brothers, man. Like, it's like, yo, get a drink and just kick it, you know? Like, talk about the kids, talk about the tour you was on, talk about what you, those, that's family.
I'ma write this here rhyme like gurus in the passenger, standing on the East Coast, staring out to Africa. Accolade, escalate fate. My vernacular remain intact for the generation that's coming after the average rapper. You praise days, number like a calendar, challenger's caliber. Mediocre into the catheter, IVs wrap em up. Mad as fuck, need a ladder up. Escalator, elevator, skyscraper, hella haters.
So, talking about the producers, you work with legends like Primo, Pete Rock, Large Pro, Alchemist. Who's next on your to-do list? Who you want to work with?
I would like to work with DJ Khalil, Ninth Wonder. I would like to work with, I've only done one record with Large Pro, and I need to do more because Large Pro is one of my favorite producers of all time. So that one is not enough. One is not going to cut it. You know, one is not going to cut it with Pete Rock. You know, one is not going to cut it with a lot of people. But Large Pro especially, Pete Rock especially. But Khalil, like I said, Ninth Wonder. I like Big Crit. Let me think, who else? Apollo Brown. And actually, me and Apollo Brown are doing a project. And when we do that, won't beat people over the head with that, but Apollo Brown is a phenomenal producer, and I want to work with whoever's dope, man. You know, I just want to do dope records. Justice League, I like Justice League a lot. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's so many phenomenal producers out there, and I tip my hat to all the cats that are up and coming, all the cats that are, like, you know, keeping the trail for the good music.
And what is your goal for the near future now? Your next steps?
My objective is to get Goggle Grenades off the ground. We got a bunch of artists that we're working with. Lucky Dice is an artist that I'm in a group with called M. Diesel. Lucky Dice and Chinox. We formulate a group called M. Diesel, and we got music coming. We got Singapore Kane, who, you know what I'm saying, he's made his rounds with Big Shug, and a female rapper by the name of Ayadonna, who we're working with. A few singers, Jay Tronius, Danny Sky High McLean, a band by the name of Planet Ubiquity. We got a lot coming up this year. Goggle Grenades is about to, like, we're about to formulate outside of like, you know, just the Rex aspect of things. We're gonna show like the artistic side of so many artists out there that are just not getting the shine that they deserve. So, you know, shout out to Blaze P, shout out to Anthem, shout out to everybody that we're working with that's just like, you know, making that quality hip hop, and we're about to take it by storm. Raw Spillage, I could go on for days, man. We got crew for days, man. So it is what it is.
So you're not only the artist, but you're also in the background doing things.
I want to do like, you know what I'm saying, a little bit of that extra, you know, like kind of A&R project, executive produce with the rest of the homies, and kind of like help homies around the way, like formulate the projects that they've been trying to make for the longest period of time, and like people ain't giving them the time of day. So we want to make it official where like we have a unit. The tough thing about Massachusetts is that like there's so much talent, but unlike a Houston or an Atlanta or a Miami, Florida, like out there, cats kind of unify and they work to like make sure everybody's uplifted and everybody do their thing. So with this Gargle Grenades movement, like, you know what I'm saying, what we're saying is we're gonna take everybody's movement and we're gonna catapult it. We got a female by the name of Easy Dread. She produces, she sings, she engineers, you know what I'm saying, like, and we're just trying to shine a light on that, you know, like. Never mind, like, you know, the egos and all that extra shit. Dope is dope. Right. Talent is talent. You recognize talent, let's just put a light on it. You know what I'm saying? And like, just have people get what they've been craving for the longest period of time. Like, don't want the same bullshit all the time. You know, even in, you know what I'm saying, the underground scene, when you have an artist that you know is a dope lyricist, but they keep giving you the same material. They're not testing the waters, and they're not trying to do anything different. So like with my music, I'm trying to like infuse like different sounds and different ways of doing what I do, but still just keeping it raw boom bap, you know? Cause that's what I do. I'm raw boom bap, but at the same time, like, you know, there's a lot of like, you know, artistic sides to me, you know?
Listen, I think they want the new PE now. Ice Cube, nigga with an attitude now. They want a dude who's immune to the rules. Short fuse aiming at Q, Bishop on the roof now. They want me to say, fuck who in the game. If you the best rapper alive, then Rex insane. I think Cream's insane. Best producer alive, me upon his tracks like needles to the veins.
So you heard it, Rex going nowhere, he's staying busy. Thank you for taking time, and the last word's yours, sir.
Appreciate you for taking the time. Yeah, so I appreciate y'all for like, you know, taking the time with me, Backspin TV. Once again, I go by Rex, Rhythmatic Eternal King Supreme. And look, I'm writing this with ether yet again, and the burner's still pointed at the brain, cause these rappers still killing the game. Holy Moses and Jesus upon my knees, I plead to you again. Send them all to Lucifer's fame, sorry mama, but fuck Obama. I ain't really seeing no change, the hope is gone, focus on the pain, the guru gone. Read your letter, fuck your letter, Solar is to blame. I hope somebody pop your shit with hollow tips, sorry it's too obvious, you niggas is a counterfeit. Think of classic Keith Alarm, nothing you do count for shit. Bitch made, please swallow a switchblade, dig grave, take a dive in Rex, I'm back riding. All the talk of Waka Flocka pop up and I'm still hating his name. Gucci this, Plies that, why rap, won't bring up the revolution. Chuck D's evolution, fuck these niggas, nigga Biggie Smalls king.
To say goodnight, I'ma blaze a mic willingly. Killer be kill industry, in the realest of real MC. Solar flow enemy, future of the rap, golden era dead.
No time for looking back,
it's
done.
We in the 25th hour, it's now or never. We gotta get it for it's gone forever. Remember, in the end time waits for no man. What's your plan?
No time for looking back.